Greetings, family. This is Bomani Temba, and we're live on Revolutionary Cam. We're here at Bomani Technology, and I'm rocking my Tanzania jersey as we get ready for Tanzania November 20th to the 30th. I have two of my good brothers here. They're going to introduce themselves to you, and we're going to get into some nice, deep conversation about traveling, living, and doing business in Africa.
All right. Greetings, everyone. My name is Tameen Ben Yehuda, and I'm here representing One Eden Incorporated and the Shubla Kaya Ghana.
And I'm Brother Shlomo, and I'm here really just to find out some information about the different countries in Africa.
And perfect, that will work. So family, we're going to get into some wonderful conversation, and my brothers here have some questions from here as we're here meeting and talking about this movement to Africa. So let's get into some of the questions.
Like we was, you know, asking you earlier, basically we have people who are in the Americas that's looking to repatriate back to Africa. And, you know, I began a series of questions myself asking, and basically we need to look at the foster economics, you know, as far as housing, the cost of housing. Some people are looking to buy land. And there's so many different things on YouTube, you know, so many different people on YouTube that have information, so it's kind of hard to really sort out good information versus bad. Me, myself, I have been following you for about a year and a half, 2 years, and I've seen basically what made your video stand out. You just cut straight to the chase, got to the most, you know, informative part versus entertainment and, you know, trying to get subscribers. But the information was solid, you know. So basically, I just wanted to, like I said, meet you personally and commend you to keep up the good work, because again, your information has been a source for me and others that's been right on time, right on point.
Well, I appreciate you reaching out, and that's why I do my best to connect with those of us that's trying to make the move, and then kind of just make sure that we share with everyone what we're working on, which is, you know, the biggest thing we're working on is our Black Star Pan-African Community, which is 15 acres of land there in Jahadzi. It's a small town outside of Winneba in Ghana. And then we have another 50 acres that's connected to that to make it 65 acres, phase one and phase two. And the goal is to, you know, to really build something to where when you're ready to make a move from the diaspora, you have things set up where you're part of a community where you can put your resources together and you can be more effective in the country. You can connect more with your Ghanaian brothers and sisters, and you could begin to just, you know, organically put something together where you're operating from a position of power and a position of order, and then that makes you a better fit on African continent, because, you know, it's a situation where we're not going to a welfare state to where, you know, if things go wrong, the government got all kind of programs to take care of you and things like that. So we have to come with our best game. So that's how we came up with. Other people have decided that they're going to move by themselves, and some people decide they're going to work in small groups, which is what I definitely recommend. And then, you know, the bigger the group, you know, is fine, but you have to be more on, you know, working as a team to, you know, make that work. But the individual thing don't work. You see people, you know, and some people have their different reasons why they're in countries. Some people are in countries to do documentation and maybe just kind of build a base of them becoming a professional traveler or someone that's just establishing certain things for themselves, a name and things like that. So not everybody is there living and doing business in Africa for the purpose of repatriation. Right. And what I try to do is define what repatriation is. Now, repatriation or repatriation is an energy of our people from the African diaspora, stolen Africans, that's returning to the African continent and being there for the purpose of nation building, to where we're working together with the best of our people in Africa to establish something to where we as a people can do more global black power pan-African business together to solve our different issues as a people versus complaining or versus using different ways to find to feel like we just need to just talk about the issues versus doing it. So that's how we came up with, and you know, it's not a situation where you have a bunch of people who have built communities. As much as different chiefs have given free land, we don't have established communities where I can say, hey, this is a community of 50 different black people from the African diaspora that put their resources together and build certain things. That is not established. If anyone knows those things established, they can let me know. But the groups I've worked with, they put a very poor effort into making it work and didn't dedicate the time to handle the management side of it. and also the marketing aspect of it, and different mm-hmm. aspect to where you're building something from the grassroots,
right,
and things like that. It's something that we're working on, because we see the best position for us is corporate economics. Because when you think about the Chinese, the Indians, they're coming as entities. You know, right. Some of their governments are literally just funding them to come and build business and build enterprises in Africa. So they're already ahead on you. So if you think you can just wing it with your individual mindset, it's not going to happen. So that's why we came up with our group, Black Star Pan-African Community. Right now, it's 65 of us, and our goal is to grow, because we have a whole lot more land in phase two left, where individuals can reach out to us and get a nice 80 by 100 plot of land for a nice price of $3,000 that includes $500 administrative costs, which helps to pay for all of our legal process, to take care of our lawyer, our consultant, people we have on the ground clearing the land, setting the land up. You know, it's a whole lot go into it, but when you put your money together, you can now pay for all of those things, and you can run like an enterprise to where you're creating positions, and you know, you're creating a payroll based on administration costs. And it's a different business tactics that takes a lot of work and take a lot of management skills. But here at my office, Bomani Technologies, we have the highest level of technology, computers and organized folders and drives and things like that, all set up to just manage the work. And then you just stay on top of your communication game. You know, now you have apps like WhatsApp and things like that, and Facebook groups, where you can just organize your groups and communicate.
Okay. I have a question for you, since you was talking about enterprise and entities. How would a person go about setting up a company in Ghana?
Right, perfect. The best way we have saw that, because our company, Black Star Pan-African Community, is being established as a legal entity in Ghana, as a limited corporation, or kind of what you call an LLC here. Mm-hmm. And a limited liability company. And in this case, we also have options to set up it as NGOs and different things like that. And you know, we just started really working on this operation since September last year. So we're still trying to put things together. But what you do in this situation, since you have a company lawyer, you have your attorney take care of the paperwork, and then you just put together your board members, and it's just a series of process. So it's like, most of the things we can get done in Ghana, because most of our group are here, is because we have people there on the ground that we have established relationship to work on it. During the COVID shutdown, there's so many things that we need to get done, but we can't, like, I can't afford to leave here and go back and forth to Ghana, especially when I'm trying to build business in another country and things like that. So you're going to have to find people to trust, and my level of trust is accountability, where everything that you're getting paid for, you're getting paid as you go along, and you're doing the work as you go along. Mm-hmm. So we're able to just get that done for you. But when you set those things up by yourself, it takes a little more legwork in the country and things like that. And then some processes take a little time, so you may want to have somebody who's more of an attorney, because the people that they're going to have to deal with are also other lawyers and things like that. So you just never know who knows each other. So you just got to get the right people inside to do the work for you. Okay. But other than that, you have to, you'd have to have your, you get your tax ID number. You'd have to get your business plan all together. And most important thing, it's your board. Okay. Now, the business plan, you don't have to have all of that. But right. It's like I'm telling people, don't ever think about doing business without having a business plan.
Right.
And beyond that, the things that you're going to need to get, again, the lawyer is going to really just need to be the functional part, because if you need to get certain documents as far as certain utility bills and things like that, okay, they'll be able to do that. And so that's my recommendation.
Okay.
If you don't want to do it that way, you just have to find someone that I would consider a consultant.
Mm-hmm.
So it's either I'm telling you to do it with a Ghanaian lawyer or a Ghanaian consultant. And a Ghanaian consultant could be somebody that's with a good relationship, that they know this process of doing business, and they help you. So I've done it both times, and both times I've used those two different options. The first time was with two consultants that was appointed to me as a good friend of one of my closest associate. And everything I'm talking about, just like everywhere else, is based on relationships.
Right.
And you know, if you don't have the proper relationships, you're going to go down the wrong road.
Okay. Because I know, like, myself, Brother Uziahu, which is on a conference call with us, he's basically one of our partners in Ghana that we partnered. We set up our business in 2015. And I noticed with our partners, they gave us the advice to partner with a Ghanaian because it was more economical to do it that way versus coming in as a 100% foreign owned. The cost was going to be more to do it that way. So do you know, as far as pricing, what's the administrative cost on those things to get set up?
Yes, one of those things where you've seen in the quote unquote writing that it's $500,000 if you're coming a sole proprietorship, or $250,000 if you're coming with a Ghanaian partner. And the numbers, when you look at it, can you know, kind of flip, but it's up there in those hundreds of thousands
right.
of dollars.
Exactly.
Before, I remember it was $10,000 with a Ghanaian partner and $30,000 if sole proprietorship. But you know, there's ways of working those things, and that's what I mentioned to individuals. They literally have to get an attorney to work it out, or a consultant, because it's going to be too complex for us to understand, and some of the political stuff that goes behind those things,
right.
you don't want to get yourself too drawn away to where it gets confusing. I see people make videos of being frustrated of doing things in Ghana, and people like myself, I don't have that kind of issue, because you realize that, first of all, I'm not, you know, not from Ghana directly anyway, and everything that you're going to deal with anywhere else in any country, it deals with the culture of it. You know, just like my family, we came from Jamaica and we came here.
Right.
We had to learn the culture of how to speak American English, or people just wouldn't understand us.
Right.
And we had to learn the culture of just how things are done in the country. And then and then the same thing I had to learn when I went to Ghana. The only difference is Ghana is a little simpler for me because it's the same climate as Jamaica.
Right.
But you know, nevertheless, you end up having to learn these things. So for my brothers and sisters that's born in America, it's one of those things we always try to just get us to understand from that perspective and
right.
things like that, because you know, and even with the passports and the visas and things, which is another subject.
Okay. So yeah. Also, when it comes to shipping vehicles and things of that nature, or equipment, how do you have any recommendations on how that should go?
We have a good shipping connection with one of our Ghanaian brothers that live in Europe. And he has a shipping company where he has his connections in different parts of the place that we're going to be from, East Coast, West Coast, Southeast, and things like that,
okay.
To where the deal is. And the way we work these things out, once we establish a relationship, our consultant or legal connection will connect with their management people in the country. And then what we do is work out to explain to our, okay, once our different group members get all of their stuff together and your guys come to their house and pick it up and you put it in this big shipping container, now how are we going to get it when we get to Ghana? Mm-hmm. So they have it worked out to where they identify your shipping container and those who have it set up, and then it will get to you on your property. So it's a whole stream of connections of everyone who has to know each other, and everything has to be taken care of to get it from this side to that side.
Okay.
So that's what you end up having when you have this. You know, you have a team where we can now just add other people on, where we say, you know, we're going to work together and you're going to take up all the shipping for all of our group.
Right.
And that's, you know, that's your money right there. But at the same time, too, if you don't take care of our people, we can't do certain business.
Right.
So the strength in numbers is what I've always used in business ever since we started doing these tour groups to different parts of Africa. And that gets you respect, and that puts you in a force of how you can make real deals and make it work.
Mm-hmm.
So those are one things that we have set up for our group members.
Oh, okay. Brother Shlomo, you have any questions?
Well, I had a question earlier. I know you was telling us about, you was talking about the East and the West. West
right.
Africa, East Africa, and I was asking about, I wanted to know the political stability. Like even in a region like in Ghana, like I know most people here in America, you know, they, Hollywood tells a lot. So a lot of us are familiar with the Rwanda situation and I knew you speaking of earlier how Rwanda has progressed from their situation to a flourishing, prosperous country.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to know what is the political situation in these regions, and how stable are there for, I guess you can say, for protection, for the most part?
Yeah, great question. I wish I had some people that were more into the political analysts, like some good friends of mine. But moreover, what you have seen in Africa is a growth of stability as far as countries. At one point, you used to see a few civil war and civil unrest. And as decades go by, you see less of it and less of it. And then what you do see, you see more unions coming together trying to solve their problems. And I'm not saying that these unions are fixing all of the different problems, whether it's the regional association like the East African Federation or ECOWAS, or the African Union, or the different government bodies working together. But you do have an energy of those conversations happening. So when you start to have more of that, then you have less chance of civil unrest and less chance of certain things. And that's what we have seen. So that's one of the more positive things. And then you're seeing transfer of government to where it's more peaceful than anything else. And as the decades go by, because you're talking about from the 1950s to now 2020, that's seven decade span. So, you know, in a situation where we feel like we as a people are learning, and then more and more countries are opening up, realizing that there's an African diaspora, and in order for Africa to be great again, that African diaspora has to be a part of it. The only country I've seen this, you know, you see different things here and there, whether it's Nigeria, maybe Ethiopia, more of the bigger countries, and you see one or two things, but it's, I just feel like Africa is as stable as it has been in the last few decades, and it's the perfect time for us to give our energy, and our energy would also just change things out. So that's why I'm reaching out to people in general, saying, hey, the future of Africa is based on all of us connect into Africa, and we can't sit around and wait for like this, you know, a ghost government or a ghost body of people to fix or make a perfect Africa before we can move into it. So the countries I see that's really doing well is Ghana and also Tanzania. Tanzania is a country I would have to spend my time and get to know more and travel and everything. Most of what I've done is just research and then you know, we have a lot of people in different countries, but definitely Ghana, Tanzania, and we talked about the Gambia earlier. It's a country where if 10 of us in this room decide we're gonna go there and we're gonna do things at the highest level and work together with our people there for the diaspora and the ones there on the continent, and also work with the government, within 5 years, that whole country can be transformed. And I feel like it's the same everywhere else. Even when I talk about Tanzania, I look at Tanzania, I'm just amazed at the major cities they have, the excellent job they've done on the road, the stability of their government, also their government connection into working with other countries. Because when you have a country that big and you're on the coast, then you have good access to, you know, shipping and things like that. And then your neighbors that are more, you know, landlocked, you know, you have to work together to just figure a bunch of things out.
Right.
So I'm seeing some positive things, and I think a lot of times we don't see or hear more is because those things are not presented to us, and a lot of times the negative more stand out.
So what about in the regions that you visited? You know, some countries, where I was raised, and my understanding of a lot of African countries was that a lot of countries were manipulated by European countries.
Right.
You know, and that being the Spanish, Portuguese, Dutch, French, you know, so on and so forth. So in those regions, are they solely, sovereign? Are these countries solely sovereign, or are they, do they depend on a European or a Arab supportive?
Yeah, the big issue is going to be when you look at the trade partners for each country, it's going to stand out to show the different European powers. So once you colonize a certain country and they get so-called independence, you still have a level of connection into that country. So if there's a factory that needs to be built, certain things need to be built, you know, you're going to put it to where you're going to get something from that, to where, you know, you say, okay, even though that country is independent, you know, I have the best advantage of connecting with that country because I already have my footprint in there. So,
right.
So I feel like there's a level of just white ownership that it just seems like it won't go away because they were there in a strength of power to establish certain things. Like, example, when you think of some of the most beautiful resorts around the African continent, whether it's on different islands around Africa or just on the mainland, there's a high percentage of level of just white hands in that. And then you kind of see the same thing as like in Jamaica, where they conquered or they controlled, you know, a country, and then they establish it to where when their people are ready to go to vacation and do certain things, they can enjoy the vacation. But at the same time too, they can look at it as investment for themselves, because all they're doing is really you know, it's kind of like white people supporting white people, but not in Europe.
Right.
These people have figured out some wild stuff, but it's, you know, so it puts us in an underdog situation. So, but I just feel like us just really putting our resources together and just going at it, you know, even for a good 10 years, we begin to just dominate. And even when I talk about driving out, the people who are just really taking advantage and sucking the life out of the continent, different, mm-hmm. You know, different groups, and those are, you know, and take advantage of those opportunities, make it our opportunity, and then work more with our own people, and then increase the quality of life, because a quality of life for me is not you building a few factories, and then I'm there working, and I'm making, you know, and all the money I'm making, I end up giving back to you anyway, and you just end up just being a modern day slave, and it's like, if we're not building that, and it's being built as a community where the resources are also being offset into developing the community where individuals could have a quality of life. It's just basically modern day slavery. It's the same thing that white people have done to us all over the world. So it's like, we don't need to switch slave masters from you know, white European slave master to Asian slave master, or, you know,
transfer of power,
you know, and things like that. And I understand they feel like it's day up next or whatever, but it's like, not if we have something to do with it, man.
Exactly.
And that, this is why Idi Amin had an issue with the Asians in Uganda. It's a very interesting story, and people may look at it in different ways, but, you know, look at the man that's trying to do something to say, you know what, he can't have a bunch of foreigners take over his country.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
You know, like, I don't know, there's nowhere I can think of where there's a minority of black people in any country that take over the majority of everyone else and control it. Like, it's kind of like saying there's a group of Nigerians in Malaysia and they run Malaysia.
Right.
You know, you don't, those things don't happen.
Right.
But when it comes to us, you know, you have like where I'm from in Jamaica, where it's like 95%+ of us, or 90% of us, and then you have the others, you know, which are Indians and the Caucasians.
Right.
They dominate the economics of the country.
Right.
And that's what I'm telling people, that, you know, I understand it's what it is, but it's like, this is where we're trying to put our resources together to move away from.
So with that, you know, so how, okay, so what is the cultural, okay, so it's, what is the cultural history in a place like Ghana? You know, like here in America, you know, they created this constitution where a person have the right to and the freedom to express their religious beliefs. So in those regions, is it a right for individuals to express their religious belief, or is it more like Islam controlled, or is it more like Christianity controlled, or, and when I mean by controlled, I mean by the government or the political situation as far as culture is concerned?
Yeah, the like in the northern part of Africa, which I never really know much about, that's, you know, where it's just Arab dominated, that whole life is a whole lot different. But once you move down to the other parts of Africa, you usually have a situation where you have a certain percentage of people that are Christian and Islam and others, and it tends to be a situation where you have, you know, you have harmony. Like in, I can speak for countries like Ghana, because even when my tour guide explains a great situation of how the different you know, religious group actually just, you know, they communicate and work together and get along. So that's one thing I've seen that's a plus. I haven't seen the things that I was scared about when, you know, when before I started going to Africa, because people make movies about it, talking about this, you know, if you're this belief and that belief, folks are going to come and chop you with machetes and stuff.
Right.
And it does scare you. So we have to also just educate our folks that you're free to practice your religion and things like that. What you're not free to practice is some of those other things that some people are involved with that are telling, don't bring those bad behaviors to Africa, because bad things will happen to you. You know, you can might as well stay in America, because America is gonna accept all your bad behaviors and things like that, and so on. So, yeah, I know what I'm talking about. I don't have to explain it, family.
right. So, Brother Bomani, as far as the different areas, I know you're going to be going taking the tour in December, but some of the areas that you're covering, what is the you know, the economics in those areas as far as cost of living and things of that nature, you know, as far as if you person want to decide to live, we know Accra, you know, cost of living is higher there, but some of the other areas and some of the other regions, what would it be for some person that's on a budget that, you know, it needs to balance their budget, what would you suggest as far as certain areas to live in?
It's perfect. The areas that I personally recommend are going to be around the Winneba area. That's going to be about 90 minutes away from Accra.
Okay.
And all the way up to Cape Coast, Elmina, which would be another 90 minutes. So anywhere from 90 minutes to all the way to 3 hours away from Accra, is ideal, because you literally put yourself in a situation where the cost of living is lower, but at the same time too, you have access to the tropical beach areas and things like that. And there's just too much going on in Accra anyway, so I tell people, if you're going to invest, especially buy land, you're going to get it more in the central region. So that's kind of the areas you recommend. But also, when you're thinking about the Volta region, Braunhofer region, those are other regions outside, where it's a few hours outside of Accra, where you can just get more land for a better price. The cost of living is cheaper, so if you get more land, your goal is to just grow more of what you want to grow and things like that. So the cost of living and the cost of land just completely just go down. An example, if you're in Accra, you may be paying for a plot of land, it may go from anywhere from $5,000 to $20,000. Mm-hmm. And that's 80 by 100. And yeah, once you start stepping out, you begin to hear prices from as low as literally $500 all the way to about $3,000.
Okay.
And that's like the big difference. So what I mean, the major cities are like overrated.
Right.
It's like you go there and go broke.
Right.
And it's a serious situation. So that's where it has to be planned at long term. But you can find affordable situations in the city, Accra. But even if you do find it, by the time you look at what the cost of everything costs, it's almost still double or triple.
Right.
And so it's hard to really put the pinpoint of how the cost of living works. Only thing I would tell people is make sure they keep away from Accra. Go there like you're a tourist, and that's about it.
Yeah, okay.
And other than that, the more you can just kind of eat off the land, and the more you can be self-sufficient. Like example, if you have a nice solar package and you have a nice catch water system, now you're beginning to save money on your utilities, and also beyond the save money on your utilities, if you want to have a consistent power or consistent water, it's best if you build that supply on your own.
Okay.
And city water is harder to get the further you step outside the city, so it's also an encouragement to say, hey, you want to go more sustainable. And so all those aspects is what's going to reduce your cost of living.
Okay.
And then the opposite is going to increase it. So that's what I kind of just tell people when they make that decision.
Okay. Well, I guess that's about it for me.
That's about it for me as well.
And your wife is just smiling.
explaining to us earlier about the shots. Because people are under the impression that we have to
take a bunch of shots.
These shots are mandatory.
Right.
So can you explain to us?
Well, perfect. Yeah, mandatory list of shots would be from even the government itself, whether it's the embassy or on the government website, as far as Ministry of Tourism. And there's nothing that say you're required to take yellow fever or any bunch of shots. Now, yellow fever is a recommendation was given, but what you have now is COVID-19 is mandatory, meaning that it's, you go on the embassy website, you go on here, even have the president himself explaining that you have to have a COVID test that's showing that it's COVID-19 negative before you get to the country, that shows it's been taken within the last 3 days. And that's like the only mandatory situation. And they're saying when you get there also now, hopefully they drop this foolishness that you have to take another COVID test that you got to cash out and pay them. So it's like, they're like, okay, you're going to, them folks is getting that money, we also want to get some of it.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's directly like that or if it's something that's really concerned, but that's one of the only countries I know, Ghana, that's doing that. I'm heading to Tanzania, and I'm always reading the requirements to go into countries as I go over with my group. And Tanzania just have literally just, you just do the same COVID test, 19 tests, and show a negative result, and show that it was good for within the last 3 days, and you're good to go. And also, their visa process is simple. I did me and my son visa, and it got back with us within 5 days. Now, their visa process is simple because everything has to be uploaded to their website, from your passport page to your passport style photo to your flight itinerary and things like that. And then you just send in all your information digitally, and then the visa is sent to you via email. So those are some of the things that make you feel good about going to a country that's less stress right there versus what I just explained to you with Ghana, where even you have to send your passport off. So you're hoping that countries are looking at each other competitively and say, you know what, this country is doing well by having this practice, let me do that. Because the other country that I want to mention is South Africa. They're completely closed, and that's how we are having this conversation with Tanzania.
Okay.
Because I was set to go to South Africa, it was like 25 of us, and then they were one of the only countries that didn't actually open back up. You know, from right now, the last thing I saw in there, I saw from South Africa, because I go and check these different things online, it shows that literally USA is on the ban list. And they also was talking about opening up next year also.
Right.
So I was like, okay, if they don't want our folks here from America, then you know we go to another country.
Right.
So the country that's always been on the list of next, which you never get a chance to go to, was you know Tanzania, Rwanda, and Uganda, and also even going back to Kenya, just you know East Africa, because that's where I don't have a lot of presence in.
Right.
Outside of just the trip in Ethiopia in 2017. And then an older trip in 2005 to Kenya. But Tanzania was just the clear ideal because we're trying to do something that was, you know, you take these things personal when South Africa did that. So he was like, okay, I'm going to find me a better country in Africa than South Africa that offers a better itinerary. And, you know, the itinerary, right, we just usually write these incredible itinerary routes and culture.
Right.
And now we just added the beach resort in Zanzibar and just, you know, kind of set up to where this it turned out to be one of the better itineraries that we have done.
Okay.
And it's one of the things I'm trying to tell people, and, you know, I don't, you never know who's listening, but it's like the different governments going to have to step their game up because it's a competition, you know. It's not like all of us that want to go to Africa is going to be able to make it to 50-something countries. It's just not going to happen.
Right.
Some of us maybe 2-3, some of us 15, 20, and so on. So they're going to base their decisions on all of those different things.
Okay.
And so at the end of the day, Tanzania stand out, what they're doing. And it's, you know, you end up just wanting to show love and connect to the countries that are serious.
Okay.
So my question, perfect.
My question is for as being in Ghana, and getting everything prepared to go over. How is it that when women get there and businesses being started by women, and like far as restaurants, hotels, spas, is there a license? Like I'm licensed here, do I have to be go to the embassy to be licensed? Let them know that I'm licensed when I get there.
You do have to go through a process of since you're going there as a visitor and you have your visa. Now the next thing is you know you do work permits and then residency and to where you're working towards citizenship. That whole process. So you do have to get you know when you're doing certain business there you do have to get it registered and set up. And then if you are a professional, you may have to just get that license there. In some cases you don't, but that's where the field research will come in handy. In those things when we have, you know, like our attorney, whenever we have legal questions like that, we just run that by him directly, and the same thing with our consultant. So that's how we get clarity on the ground.
Okay. Yes, indeed. Well, thank you, Brother Bomani, for taking the time out, man, and inviting us to your studio, man, so we can sit down and build with you, man. We appreciate you taking the time out for us.
Well, appreciate the questions and everything, and hopefully this we've been able to just answer a lot of you know questions and get into certain dialogue to just get people to open their minds up, because I really feel like if we go to the different countries with an organized game plan and open our mind to say, hey, I'm not going to run from my black folks in the diaspora when I get there, because I always hear people talk about, you know what's going on in the country. I understand. Yeah, you're going to a country, so you're gonna be connecting with the people in the country.
Right.
But what's more important is where you came from. You can't forget the people you came from because you have so much alike, and your survival is gonna depend on that.
Yes.
So what is the process of being a part of the group, the small group that you guys have already started, 65?
Yes, as far as that group. Black South Pan-African Community. Once you get to our website, africaforafricans.org, we have a link on there, let's say Black Star Pan-African Community. And what we have set up, we have this from introduction all the way to bylaws, our committees, getting started with the application process, cancellation policy, and overview. We have a full load of details on there for you to go through, and then we have an email with the application that you fill out. So once you fill out the application and you send in your sign-off sheet for your bylaws and your overview, understanding that you understand the community process, and then you send in your deposit. We just process you to where, you know, we just put you on the list and add you to the groups, and then you know you begin to just connect and build with us, and you pick your plot when it's time to pick your plot, and we just go through that whole process with you so you're clear. But it's a little work, and the main thing is literally for individuals to read 100% of the information so they know they're making the right decisions and the proper decision, and then also for them to understand mentally that you're working with a group of people from African diaspora that have went through the same process as you. So the main thing now is for you to understand you have to be a team player with everyone else, and you also have to contribute to everyone else. So those are some of the finer things beyond just them even being clear of all the specs of the community itself. And once they do all those things, as the phase and the process begin to just go, it'll be easier for us to get somebody, give them the graph of the community and say, these are the plots available. You select your land, then they'll be able to go to a process where they pay for their registration and survey, and then they get a building permit, and they'll be able to select a builder to where they can say, this is what we want. And we get them a contract that's signed and stamped by a lawyer or a consultant to where they can start building. And then kind of just go through that process where everything is organized and laid out for you. Right now it's going to take a little bit of time to go through that whole process, but as the next 6 months come, we'll be able to get people to a faster process to where within a few months they're able to start building. So I know it's a lot of information in that, but that's because other people skip those stages and things like that, right. And in a way you get caught up, but I try to just tell it from the beginning to the end. And then, you know, once you build your community and you're in the community together, the biggest advantage is literally all of us are planting fruit trees around our house, and we have a 5 to several acres of land for farming where we can plant all the things we need to plant, and then everything is shared in the community. Mm-hmm. And it begins to be one of those communities where you're sharing everything and you're putting your resources together, because you're going to have to do that in order to build the rest of the community. Because if you go to other people, you know, to get a piece of land, okay, now you got your piece of land, now who's going to do the other parts of that community or town?
Yes.
You know, and that's what you end up seeing. You know, yes. So if you're going to do one of these things, you either need to know about what other people are going to be doing. With us, it's simple because it's a community, so all of us are going to build this whole community together to where you see us and our children out there doing the streets.
Right.
To where it's one of those, you know, like the military concept, all hands on deck.
That's right.
Where everybody participates. So if you have children, they can participate. Everyone can do something in the community. And together, you know, you build something where it's just literally this independence. So I'm telling people, if you're interested in this community, it's a serious setup, but you have to be committed to doing the work. So if you're committed to doing the work, check out the information and reach out to me, and we'll talk about it, and then we'll get you started. And I'm always available to answer all questions, because I believe it's most important that you're clear about information before you commit. So I tell people, if you're trying to move to Africa and you have questions and you need other opinions, you don't have to worry about paying a third, fourth, fifth consultation charge. You call me. It's free consultation if you're looking to travel, live, or do business in Africa. And if you're in the area, just like our brothers here, you come meet with us, talk with us, and then we just build a relationship and we look out for each other. There's no need for us to be just about money. I understand we all have to make money and do business, but let's try to hear what our people have to say and talk with them, because you never know, they may be a great energy where they can become business partners, and it's more important if we can actually come together and do business, and so on. But anyway, family, hopefully everybody is clear on those things, and if not, just connect back out with us. And let me know if you guys have any last minute questions before we close.
Yes, brother Uziahu, he's on the conference line. He has a question for you. Go ahead, brother.
Hey, shalom. Yeah, this is Uziahu. I represent the Afro-Latinos Group. My question was concerning the NGO, the nonprofit. How does that work compared to here? And if you have a nonprofit here, are you able to transition that or set up something over there as well?
All right, perfect. Great question. Now, as far as the questions on nonprofit, and this is honestly why I wanted to put our money together to add to our administrative staff, myself as an administrator, and then I have a lawyer, because he's the one that's going to really just educate and explain those things to us. As far as your NGO, you can get it set up there in Ghana. I've seen other people set up their business in Ghana that way. But as far as the in-detail process, that's where you really need to have an attorney or a consultant assist you with those things when you're actually ready to go. But as far as the capability of getting what you need to get done there, absolutely. That's part of the list of business entities that you can set up in Ghana.
Okay, thank you.
Right, absolutely our family.
Any more questions?
No, that's it. I appreciate
it. Perfect. All right, we appreciate everyone, family. So we'll close out the session, family. And as time goes along, we promise we're going to have more information about the different business enterprise and things like that. As a matter of fact, I'll see if I can get our attorney to put together a session of going through the different things and all of the details. And I'll also do some additional research, that way we can just keep you connected. But family, anything you want to do in Africa that you're doing here, let's connect and make it happen. So family, until the next session, the journey continues.